difference between Dostoevsky and Nietzsche in this regard, because their ideas are very similar in many, many ways. They're like, one's more rational and explicit and one's more narrative and literary, but they're like the same spirit. But Dostoevsky is in some sense deeper, and I think Nietzsche would have agreed with this, and I know that Nietzsche knew more about Dostoevsky than people thought. There's been recently scholarly work on that account. Dostoevsky, in some ways, was closer to beauty. His work was closer to beauty than Nietzsche's, because Dostoevsky's work was literary and artistic, and so he dealt in that aesthetic realm. And The Idiot, for example, The Idiot's a very interesting book, because, and you see this in other bits of Dostoevsky's work as well, is that his most ethical characters can lose every argument with rationalists and still be better men. And you see that in the book, because the book allows them to be embodied rather than mere carriers of propositional arguments. And beauty is non-propositional. And so it goes under our narcissistic and blind rational intellect that overvalues its ability. That's the spirit of Lucifer that Milton warned everyone about. It goes under that and grabs you. And if you pay attention to that, then it's a pointer to what is beyond your understanding. And so it's vital. It's vital. And Dostoevsky knew that. And Solzhenitsyn read that and he thought, I see what he means. I understand what he means. And you know, one of the characteristics of our modern culture, especially in the architectural realm, is that it's replete with ugliness. I mean, I've gone to medieval villages in Europe, especially in what used to be East Germany, that were so beautiful. They just made me cry when I was in the downtown. I thought, my God, this is so unbelievably beautiful. How did people manage this? And to think about all the effort that was poured into those cathedrals, monuments to divine beauty. What imagination those people had, and what commitment. And we can't do that. Modern people can't do that. And so it's a terrible loss. And it's partly because we just don't take such things seriously. And that's a big mistake, because they are more serious than anything else. Beauty, that's more serious than anything, except perhaps truth. But it's a pointer. You know, and these religious thinkers, philosophically speaking, Christian thinkers, they thought of God as the summum bonum, the sum of all good things. Well, truth is something, and beauty is something, and courage is something. These virtues that we all recognize as virtues, or are tormented by our conscience if we don't. You sum those all together, that's the ideal that binds us all. And that's God for all intents and purposes. You might say, well, is that real? It's like, well, it depends on what you mean by real. And people laugh at me because I say that sort of thing fairly frequently. You know, it depends on what you mean by real. But when you ask the question, is something real? It's like an equation. And the right response to that is, well, what do you mean by real? And you think, well, that's an evasion. It's like, no, I'm just not accepting your presuppositions as a precondition for this discussion. You can't use that sleight of hand. So beauty, it's like, beauty tells you to be more than you are. Beauty tells you to aspire to that which is beyond you. Beauty says there is something beyond you, all of that. And it does that in an enticing manner, right? It invites you to come along. It's the opposite of authoritarianism. It's an invitation. It's like the most beautiful woman you can possibly imagine waiting there for you on the dance floor, inviting you. That's beauty. And that's an invitation to be the sort of man who could dance with that person. You think you don't take that seriously? Like, you get rejected by some woman you admire, that her beauty has captivated you, and you're rejected because you're less than you could be. You think you don't take that seriously. It's a miracle you don't cut your throat. You take it seriously. You just don't know it. You don't know what she's angry about. Why is she rejecting you? It's because you're not all you could be. and some of that's laid at your feet. And men are angry with women all the time because that's what women do. That's what they tell them all the time. And it's a terrible thing. But can you blame them? What else would they do? And what else would you want them to do? You know, in your shallow thoughts, you'd think, well, I wish that I was always accepted. Every advance was accepted uncritically. Well, that world would be hell very rapidly if it was actually the case.